Lux presents a Raycom Video Enterprises presentation.
5 seconds left. Petway launches and hits it with 3 seconds to play.
3 seconds. Two. Cortiani, the buzzer might go off. No basket. It won't count. It won't count. Wake Forest has won. The buzzer sounded before he got the shot away.
And the inbound pass stolen by Scott.
He scores!
Since 1953, ACC basketball has thrilled its fans with a lot of great games. But the ones that stand the test of time are the ones highlighted by a great finish. From the regular season classics to the tournament thrillers, these are the ACC's greatest finishes. Super Sunday, 1990. In New Orleans, the NFL's 49ers were about to trounce the Denver Broncos 55-10 in the most lopsided match in Super Bowl history. But here in Wake Forest's Joel Coliseum, the competition was much more evenly matched. Virginia and Wake Forest traded ties and lead changes throughout the second half and into overtime, which produced two more ties and eight lead changes. Then entering the last minute, Wake Forest went up by two.
Got Carter to deal with. To the bucket.
Good layup. Good layup by Carlisle.
Deacons by two and a minute to go in overtime.
That was a fine play because he had to put the dribble down just to get free.
Stiff. Out to Turner, now to Crotty. Cavaliers getting set. 26 seconds on the shot clock. Stiff firing.
He got fouled. He sure did.
Tie game at 68.
You can't play a better basketball game than Stiff has played today.
Stiff hits the free throw to put them up by one.
22 lead changes in this game. There have been 11 times, and the Deacons are down one. And that's the time remaining. Shot clock is off.
Man-to-man by Virginia.
Seiler has a two-point shot, and the Deacons lead.
Good call by Dave Odom. Seiler's been the man with a hot hand all day. Make sure he at least touches it once. Crotty almost walked.
Daniel, now to Crotty. 10 seconds. 9. Wake Forest leads by one. It's going to be Crotty inside. Tip ball. Stiff has got it. Fires.
He takes that shot. Did he? Timeout.
March 4, 1989, the last game of the regular season for NC State and Wake Forest. State had 9 conference wins, Wake just 3. But this was to be another day in the ACC where tough luck teams forget the standings and play like champions.
Cortiani into Monroe. Kelsey Weems knocked away. Oh, we've got a foul. A foul on King, and he just missed the shot. Oh, my goodness.
Kelsey Weems makes the first of two, then State calls a timeout to set up a deliberate miss.
77-75. Wake Forest, 2 seconds left. Second shot for Kelsey Weems. He misses it. The rebound. Stick ball! Tie game! We're going to overtime! It counts!
Wake gets the first 4 points of the extra period. But State fights back and is in a position to tie.
Looking to tie. Got it. 7 seconds. 6, 5. Wake Forest is going to hustle it up here. McQueen can't get it off. Double overtime.
In the second overtime, State trails again. But Monroe hits to send it into a third OT.
1 second left.
Derrick McQueen taking the ball out. You don't expect a lob pass because of big Brian Howard there.
Boy, can't get it off. We've got a fourth overtime. The first time in the 36-year history of the Atlantic Coast Conference, a game has gone into 4 overtime periods.
In the fourth OT, State takes control. A tip by Howard. A layup by Brown. And Corsiani to Lester on a jam. An unbelievable shot by Monroe. And Corsiani to Brown would prove to be enough to keep Wake winless in overtime for another day. two exhausted coaches. Two exhausted teams played 60 minutes into the ACC history books to a 110-103 Wolfpack victory. That same day in the 89 season, Georgia Tech was taking on Clemson in a packed Little John Coliseum. Under a minute to go, Tech down by five, but a turnover gives them hope.
Into a five-point lead, 44 seconds left in overtime.
This one is far from being over.
Now we saw that Wednesday night, right? It's never over. This is the reason why. Got it.
Again, Georgia Tech can't call the timeout. Great fake by Dennis Scott. They got to foul this guy right now.
Brown's got to foul him. Tries to draw the charge,
and he
did.
Wow, what a play. I think that's a pretty good call. We'll take it. If we've got a replay of it, we can look at it. Shows you how much I know about it. I think he's got to foul him, but he makes a great defensive play. Now, you don't have to give the man with the ball any room. That's a great play and a real good call.
Georgia Tech can tie.
Gutsy call in that situation.
They've got to do it on the fly. They can't call timeout and try to drop a play.
Well, that's better to do it on the fly. Clemson can't get set. Derek Forrest is doing everything he can to keep it out of the hands of Dennis Scott.
Scott has it in his hands. He's going to try to do the move on his own. The three-pointer is short. What? Campbell's got it. And Clemson's going to win it.
January 12, 1991, Wake Forest at Clemson. With 8 seconds left in regulation and the Deacons trailing the Tigers 79-77, Wake Forest freshman Randolph Childress picked up his dribble. He clutched the ball for what seemed an eternity. Suddenly, he leaped, fell backward, and tossed a soft shot in over two Tigers. Game tied at 79. A stunned Clemson team went cold in the overtime, and Wake Forest went on to score 9 of the game's final 11 points to win their first conference overtime game in 17 years. On that same January day, a great finish was shaping up at Virginia's University Hall between the 13th-ranked Cavaliers and number 5 North Carolina. Virginia has a 1-point lead with 51 seconds left. Crotty makes the first of two, but misses the second, 71-69 Virginia. On the other end, King Rice takes it strong to the hoop and scores. Tie game at 71 all. Then with only 1 second on the clock, Carolina mishandles the inbounds and there's still a second left, Virginia ball. But the Cavs can't do anything in the last second either. We go to overtime. In the first overtime, with the Tar Heels up by 3 and 15 seconds left, John Crotty's three-pointer literally crawls over the front of the rim. Tied at 78, we go to a second OT. Late in the second overtime, we're tied again at 86. It's only fitting that the player who enabled the Tar Heels to get into overtime should be the one to help them get out of it. With 5 seconds left, King Rice's twisting 8-footer puts Carolina up by 2. Then Virginia called a timeout that they didn't have, resulting in a technical foul, and Rice does the honors. 1 second remains as Carolina inbounds, and the Tar Heels go on to celebrate a final score of 89-86 in double overtime. North Carolina had already lost its first two games, and with Tulane up by 2 with the ball and just seconds to go, Dean Smith's squad was in danger of becoming the first Tar Heel team since 1919 to start the season 0-3. But two Tulane players collided on the inbounds pass, and the ball bounced free. Jordan grabbed it with his back to the basket, spun, and drained a 24-footer to tie the game and send it into overtime. UNC eventually won in triple overtime. Carmichael Auditorium, where Maryland has been hot on the heels of a rare upset against North Carolina on its home floor. 15 seconds remaining, and Adrian Branch is at the line with a chance to widen Maryland's lead.
Foul shooting tonight has been critical and not very good.
He missed
again.
Carolina has a chance now to pull us off.
11 seconds left. Peterson double-teamed in the corner. Popson from 16.
Hit it!
After two timeouts, Maryland still has 5 seconds to win the game.
Bias is waiting at half court.
Oh, intercept.
And they throw it away. Hunter intercepts. And 4 seconds left, and we've got a foul. Do you believe that?
Hunter makes two free throws to ice another great finish. After trailing Maryland by as many as 16 points, NC State battles back in the final seconds of regulation in the first round of the 1978 ACC tournament. They need a basket to tie, and they get it from Tiny Pinder. It's on to overtime, knotted at 84. State leads by 3, then 2, and now Maryland needs a basket in the final seconds of overtime. JoJo Hunter delivers it. On to another overtime period, this time tied at 92. Both teams score 6 points in the second overtime, and NC State's Hawkeye Whitney has a chance to end it. But not yet. This game is going to a third overtime. In the final seconds, Maryland comes from 3 down to take the lead by 1 when Albert King is fouled by Tiny Pinder. King makes both foul shots, and Maryland leads by 3. State inbounds with 9 seconds to go. Freshman Kenny Matthews dribbles to the top of the key and shoots. And scores. Maryland inbounds against pressure. Tiny Pinder intercepts the ball and a shot is taken, but State had called time with 2 seconds left. The scoreboard tells the story. State inbounds to Matthews. 1 second left. He shoots. Short. Maryland defeats NC State in 3 overtimes, 109-108. NC State entered the 1983 ACC tournament as the 5th seed. In the first round against Wake Forest, the Pack faced elimination as the Deacs had the ball, tied at 70. But Sidney Lowe makes the big defensive play to give State hope. Lowe passes underneath to Lorenzo Charles, but Alvis Rogers makes sure the shot has no chance. With only 3 seconds to go, Charles misses the first shot, but sinks the second for a 1-point lead. Wake's desperation shot isn't close, and State advances 71-70. In the semifinals, even a bigger challenge awaits in top seed North Carolina. But with Derek Wittenberg back from a midseason injury, the Wolfpack stays right with the heels, and the game is tied late in regulation. In OT, Derek Wittenberg drains 3 of his 8 points in the extra period. Moments later, he drives the baseline past 3 white jerseys and puts State in front and into the final, 91-84 in overtime. The final presents the Wolfpack with their biggest challenge yet, 7'4" Ralph Sampson. In the second half, Othell Wilson looks to Sampson, but Thurl Bailey swats it and scores at the other end. Sampson counters with a 20-footer for his 22nd point. And the battle intensifies. Jump ball and timeout. With State in the lead, Wilson's 3-pointer hits iron and falls. But then Terry Gannon strips Sampson as he goes for the basket. And the rest is history. It's the semifinals of the 1986 tournament. In a back-and-forth game in which 6th in the nation Georgia Tech trails Maryland by as much as 8 after halftime, Tech rallies to take the lead midway through the second half. The Terps have the ball in the final seconds as we pick up the game call.
That's the 2-point
right
game.
With the basketball.
By a spinning move into the lane. Holy cow, what a shot!
During 2 timeouts, Georgia Tech designs a final play.
Trying to force Hammonds to get the ball. Now there's Long was trying to help out. He's got to get some help. There's the steal.
Loose ball. Maryland has it. Terry Long, what presence of mind.
Yes.
Long made the steal, and on the way to get the ball, he was looking at the official and said, give me a timeout.
Right now is being guarded by Dwayne Farrell. Gallon's got to get it in, and it's picked off by Farrell. He scored with 2 seconds left and was fouled.
Holy cow, what a finish. And Farrell anticipated, picked it off, and he has won the ballgame.
Well, he had nothing to lose, as we said, if he wasn't going to get the steal.
The following day, it's number 6 Tech against the number 1 Duke Blue Devils in the final game of the 86 ACC tournament at Greensboro. With both teams trading leads down the stretch, this battle was going right down to the wire.
For the first time in 8 minutes, Georgia Tech has gone back on top, 62-63.
Well, right now, Georgia Tech is saying to Duke, hey, if you're going to beat us, you're going to have to beat us with a jump shot. Good move by Henderson to penetrate.
Dawkins penetrates and got it in somehow. What a shot by Dawkins.
I love the way Duke attacks the zone. They look to penetrate, either create something for themselves or somebody else, but not to just swing the ball and be passive against the zone. They look to attack it.
Dawkins has 18 points, a game high. 1 minute, 16 seconds to go. It's a one-point ball game.
You know, we have to remember, too, these kids have played 3 straight days, 3 games, 3 tough basketball games.
Neal, after a dangerous pass down the lane, lays it in. Holy cow, what a move by Neal. And it's his first 2 points in the ball game. 55 seconds left.
Well, he made up for that missed dunk. We'll forget about that one now. Great move.
Allery, triple team. Got it. 43 seconds left. The shot clock is off, and Duke leads by 1. You couldn't ask for anything more than this. Mark Price says timeout with 35 seconds left. Bobby Kremins wants to set it up.
And that's their last time out.
66. I've loved this. This has been an absolutely wonderful game to watch.
I'll tell you something, Mitt. We'll get together and we'll fly down just to see it.
All right. Price to Neal. Keep an eye on the clock. It's in the lower right-hand side of your screen. They're trying to set up a plug. I don't think they're going to wait for the last second.
Now there's Farrell with the basketball. It's to Neal. They've got to do something. They're putting too much pressure on themselves right now. They have no timeouts. Mark Price has got to go get it.
And Neal gets the biggest shot of his life out of the corner. Missed it. Dawkins got the rebound. Fouled by Price with 7 seconds to go. Dawkins is 4 out of 7 from the free throw line. One of the great clutch shooters in the history of ACC basketball. 7 seconds to go.
Put it in the book. 1, 2. Put it in the book.
I'd hate to think he could not make everything in the last few seconds.
Well, as I said, we're at the top. Great players in this conference. MVP for what he has done for his team at Duke.
Made them both. It's a 3-point lead with 7 seconds to go. All Georgia Tech can do is hope there's a foul somewhere. Price puts it up, hits it. 1 second left. They have no timeouts. And that's it. The Blue Devils, under Mike Krzyzewski, have taken it 68-67 over Georgia Tech. And Mark Price comes over to hug and shake the hand of Johnny Dawkins.
In the 1982 tournament, there was the usual nail-biting, hard-fought, emotional contest. But looking back, if it's one thing this tournament is remembered for, it's the ACC's decision to experiment with the shot clock the following season. After trading basket for basket, Virginia and Wake Forest find their semifinal game tied at 47-all with 7 minutes and 33 seconds left in the game. Neither team would score any more in regulation. In overtime, Ricky Stokes attempts a pass with time running out, but the pass is deflected. Stokes regains possession, he shoots, and he banks it home as time expires. North Carolina, undefeated in 31 games and number 1 in the country, faces number 2 Kansas in the college basketball championship. North Carolina's Joe Quigg helps the Tar Heels to an early lead, but the Jayhawks' Maurice King connects to help bring Kansas back. Kansas now has the lead by 1. Wilt Chamberlain feeds Gene Elston to put Kansas up 44-41 with a minute 45 to go. Quigg hits from the corner. And then the Tar Heels drive to try and take the lead. Finally, Tommy Kearns is fouled. Kearns makes the free throws and ties the score. As the final seconds tick away, Carolina tries for the win, but overtime is in the cards. In overtime, Carolina leads by two, but the ball goes inside to Chamberlain, who ties it at 48. Kearns tries for the winning basket, but Chamberlain blocks it, and there's a second overtime. In the second overtime, Kearns is fouled with a minute to go. But he can't make it go, and Chamberlain rebounds. Now Kansas can take the lead. The Tar Heels' Pete Brennan fouls Chamberlain and tempers Flair. Seconds to go. Chamberlain misses, and the second overtime ends with no points scored. In the third overtime, Kansas comes from behind on a Chamberlain three-point play. Then Gene Elston is fouled, and he puts Kansas ahead with 20 seconds to go. Carolina has it, trailing by one, with a chance to win. Kearns challenges Chamberlain, who blocks the shot but fouls Quigg. And Quigg makes two to put Carolina ahead by 1 point. 6 seconds to go, but Kansas can't get it into Wilt, and the Tar Heels win, preserving their unbeaten record. February 27, 1982, number one-ranked Virginia is at underdog Maryland in the last regular season game for both squads. The big story here is that Virginia's Ralph Sampson was held scoreless until the early moments of the second half. It was 44-42 Virginia with 3 seconds left. Maryland's Dutch Morley makes a long inbounds pass to Herman Veal, who spins, shoots, and scores at the buzzer to take the game into overtime. Sampson to the line in OT, scores two, and Virginia is up by 146-45. Maryland then holds the ball for the last 4 minutes until Adrian Branch wins it for the Terrapins, hitting a 16-footer over Jeff Jones. This great upset victory in the final regular season game had Coach Lefty Driesell jumping for joy. After beating third seed NC State and second seed UNC, sixth seed Duke faced number one Maryland in the 1980 ACC Tournament Final. This is Coach Bill Foster's last ACC tournament. With 5 seconds left, Mike Jaminski's tip-in gives the Devils a one-point lead, 73-72. After a timeout, Albert King's shot misses. And though Duke's Kenny Dennard and Maryland's Buck Williams crashed to the floor under the basket, no advantage was gained and no foul was called. Sixth seed Duke had scored its third straight upset to take the tournament trophy. Here's another tournament game where a team that was supposed to bow out early didn't. After struggling through a 4-8 conference regular season, Terry Holland, in just his second year as Virginia head coach, had brought his six-seeded Cavaliers to the championship by beating the second and third seeds. Now they face the first-seeded Tar Heels, ranked fourth in the nation. With Mitch Kupchak on the bench with three fouls, Wally Walker finds his range, and the surprising Cavaliers take a 35-30 lead to the locker room at the half. But as the second half begins, North Carolina gains momentum. Phil Ford. Walter Davis. The Heels scored 12 of the first 14 points as they threatened to blow the game wide open. Coach Holland takes a timeout.
This next stretch right here is really important to us. Every single possession, ours and theirs.
His words were just what the doctor ordered as the Cavaliers turn it up a notch and begin to out-hustle the Tar Heels. Though Phil Ford continues his hot shooting for the Heels, Virginia ties the game at 60 with 4 minutes to play. Neither team can score until, with 34 seconds left, Billy Langlo converts two pressure-packed free throws to give Virginia the lead by two. Then it's the Heels' turn. Walter Davis to John Kuster, who fakes the shot and starts to the middle when a whistle stops his drive. A traveling call keeps Virginia up by two. Then, against inbound pressure, Virginia breaks the press in style. Ivorone inbounds to Langlo, who penetrates the middle and spots freshman Otis Fulton wide open. Virginia leads 64-60. 15 seconds left, Carolina inbounds to Davis, who drives the baseline but loses the handle. And the Cavaliers win it 67-62. February February 10th, 1983. It was a two-team race in the ACC this year, and these were the two teams. The Tar Heels were the 1982 national champions, but Virginia was ranked number one in 83. The Cavaliers led by 10 with 4:12 left, but then the momentum begins to swing.
4 minutes left in the basketball game. Carolina down by 10.
Oh, that's a long one.
Redick nails it for three. He has 14.
And a three-point play can bring you back in a hurry.
It's a seven-point lead for Virginia.
He turned it over.
Wilson lost the ball.
Yes, he did. He turned it over.
Double dribble called. And now with a three-point goal, Carolina could get within four. 3 minutes, 50 seconds to play. A concern, Terry Holland watching.
Watch this. He turned it over right here. The ball came up awful hard on Othell Wilson, and there's where he turned it over. That's two straight off the dribble, and that's very unusual for him.
3:45 left in the game. Braddock for three.
No, look at that Sampson. Rebound by Sampson.
And a foul is called on Sampson. Doherty hits both free throws here. North Carolina could be two shots, 2 3-point goals away from taking the lead.
It's been a very quiet comeback. You know, at one, what were they, down 14 points?
16 at one time.
16.
He has 11 points, 63-58, Virginia by five.
Let's see how it
goes. After a North Carolina foul, Virginia looks for the open man.
3:22 left in the game. There's Miller inside. Sam Perkins blocked it. Here's Carolina down by five. Sam Perkins.
Virginia has to go back to man-to-man. And here's where it's really tough to change gears. You've had a game with a big lead. Hard to get that intensity back.
Michael Jordan for three. Nope.
Cecil Exum.
Exum back up. No good. That's Perkins. He's stripped and a foul called on Othell Wilson. 2:54 left in the game. Carolina down by five. And to the line they go.
Perkins makes his free throws. And after a timeout, Sampson's at the line.
Ralph Sampson, good free throw shooter. 70% on the year, 1 for 2 in this game. He has 15 points. If he misses the first one, Carolina has a shot at the tie, and he did.
This game is a long way from being over.
Braddock, the Tar Heels down by three. A minute 13 left in the game.
Oh, a good solid
Braddock
screen.
To tie it, and then out. Tip is good.
Michael Jordan.
It's a one-point lead. Michael Jordan now with 14 points. Virginia leads by one with 1 minute to play.
Michael Jordan, remember, has four fouls on him. He's playing very aggressively. There's a steal.
Jordan takes it away from Carlisle. Bam, and the Tar Heels go in front with 50 seconds to play. 64-63, and Carmichael just erupted.
Unbelievable. Michael Jordan is so quick. And now North Carolina can afford to go back in the zone.
38 seconds to play. Carolina by one. Stokes.
Virginia's got to get organized here. They're letting a lot of clock go by.
28 seconds to play.
And North Carolina's got a big team out there playing that zone. Virginia better get the time. They're going to take it. This game has got me mesmerized. You know, I watched the first half and said, gee, these are two great teams, and we're not seeing much of a game. And then it looked like Virginia had an easy night, and all of a sudden they're behind. Here's Jordan with the steal. No question what he's going to do with it. And he has been playing with four fouls for a long time. Virginia never put any pressure on him to try to get that fifth one. And you can see how critical it is to try to put him on the bench.
23 seconds left in the game. North Carolina coming from 16 back to take a one-point lead over Virginia. The Cavaliers have the basketball.
And you can see North Carolina sitting way back in his zone. They're going to make sure that Sampson has no opportunity. And what in the world are we seeing now?
Are they going to hold for the last shot?
What? Can't imagine that.
They
sure are.
12 seconds left, and Virginia down by one is going to go for the last shot. 7 seconds left. Carlisle for three.
Long.
Rebound. Michael Jordan. And a foul call on Virginia, and Michael Jordan there again, and this ball game is over.
It's all over.
North Carolina has come from behind and won it.
Unbelievable game.
Now, this might be one of the most exciting comebacks to be led by a single player. We pick up Bill Curry's call in the second half. UNC has the ball.
Tuttle gets it down to Clark in the right corner at the free throw line. Bunning is open, and Bunning hits. 50-42. in favor of North Carolina, in favor of Duke. It's 17-24 to play. Golden into the front court, down to the right of the lane. Here he is, out to the left on the baseline to Lynn, up for the shot. It's good. There's a foul on the play. It's on Bunning. It's his third. There's the shot, and it's good. The score is 53-42 in favor of Duke. Tuttle brings the ball into the front court for Tar Heels at the top of the circle, over on the right to Delaney. One dribble, and Delaney gets it back out to Tuttle. He moves to the left. Here's over to Charlie Scott. He drives on the baseline. Fadeaway shot is good. The score is 53-44. Charlie Scott has 18, and he's going to have to get a bunch of them. The Tar Heels catch up in this ball game.
And get a bunch of them he did. As the Duke Blue Devils work to preserve their lead, sophomore great Charlie Scott begins to work his magic, grabbing rebounds, drawing fouls, and scoring from everywhere on the court. Scott closes the gap.
Tuttle gets it into Scott. Here comes Charlie, loping into the front court on the right side. Back to Tuttle at the top. Tuttle moves to the top of the circle. He stands there, gets it to Scott. Here's Scott from the right of the circle, and he hits! The score is 53-47. That's 20 points for Scott. And if he had dropped dead tonight, the Tar Heels would have been in more trouble than they are, which is considerable. In favor of Duke at 15:06. DeVinzio, he's the key to this Duke ball club. Bring the ball up into the front court. Bounce pass in the middle. Broken up by Bunning, recaptured by Scott. Here's his drive down, up for the shot. Oh, what a move! And he lays it in, 55-51. The Tar Heels have cut it to four. 13-18 to play. Duke leads by two, 56-54. Golden in the front court, left of the circle. Here he goes. Here's his drive, up for the shot, and he missed. Tapped by Lynn, no good. Vandenberg couldn't hold it. Tuttle's up with it. It's a fast break. Here's Tuttle to Scott. Scott into the lane, up for the shot, and it's good. And that ties it up at 56 all. At 12:57. Charlie Scott with 26 points has led the Tar Heel team in a great resurgence, and Duke calls for timeout at midcourt.
Shooting 12 for 13 in the second half, Scott guides UNC over Duke to its third straight ACC title. This game between 13th-ranked Georgia Tech and the Wolfpack of North Carolina State features a great comeback. Down 25-10 in the first half, Tech fought back to take a 62-60 lead. A three-pointer by Corsiani pushed the Pack back ahead 74-72 with just over a minute remaining. But Scott tied the game with a pair of free throws. State has the ball and a chance to win it in the final seconds.
Here we go.
Monroe with Oliver on him. Monroe! We've got overtime.
Great defense.
We go to action late in the overtime period with Tech up by one.
18 seconds left on the shot clock.
Looking for Monroe. Not Gugliotta for three. Of course, the Yellow Jackets have not yet been heard from this time down the floor, and it is Mr. Scott. Short. Oliver, the offensive stick back. No shot. A foul on the Wolfpack and Corsiani. He's got it.
And here's the full court pressure that you talked about. You do not want to foul.
7 seconds for Corsiani. The ball will be in Chris's hands to win the game here. Scott snuffs it, and we go to double overtime.
The second overtime came down to fouls and foul shooting. Tech would go on to win this struggle at the stripe, 95-92. This is perhaps the most exciting comeback of all time, the 1974 season final between Duke and North Carolina at Carmichael Auditorium. Trailing 86-78, UNC's Bobby Jones went to the line for two and sank both. Tar Heel freshman Walter Davis came up with Duke's inbounds pass, and freshman John Kuster scores, making it 86-82. Duke mishandles another inbounds pass, and North Carolina gets it back. Jones hits a rebound layup to cut the lead to two with 6 seconds remaining. Kuster fouls Duke's Pete Kramer, who misses the front end of a one-on-one, rebound UNC's Ed Stahl. Timeout with 3 seconds left. The Tar Heels inbound to Davis, who dribbles twice and launches a 30-footer. The ball banks in. Duke took a 3-point lead in overtime, but UNC came back to win. Carolina at Georgia Tech. Late in the game, Steve Bucknall tries to widen the slim Tar Heel lead.
As Dan said, a 76% free throw shooter. If he misses, Georgia Tech has 7 seconds to go down court and get a shot.
Even if he makes, they get 7 seconds.
That's right. And he hits it.
And with Dennis Scott in the ball game, Georgia Tech's not done yet. Even if he makes this.
A 2-point difference now.
Dean Smith is telling his team to foul.
That's right.
He's telling his team to foul. He doesn't want any 3-pointers.
Bucknall, his second is good. That might ice it. Tech will try to get it in the hands of either Brian Oliver or Dennis Scott. They're going to foul Carl Brown instead with 5 seconds to go. Now I would think Brown tries to make the first and miss the second. Of course, we can only coach so much over here. Those guys on the other side, including that man and that man, do it much better.
Nice job by Dean Smith right there.
Very nice.
Good work by our folks to pick up Dean Smith, telling his people to foul. He doesn't want any 3-pointers.
Carl Brown, 4 for 5 from the free throw line tonight.
Of course, he's got to make the first one to even set this up.
And he does.
Now, what you got to do, a lot of people, they just try to throw the ball up there on the miss. So Carl Brown's got to be real careful that when he shoots the ball, he doesn't step across the line, because the shooter can't go across the line until the ball hits the rim. Everybody else can go when he releases the ball. So the shooter has to be very disciplined in this situation.
Bobby Crimmins has told his team, if Carolina gets the rebound, to foul them. And Brown hits them both.
And the rebound pass stolen by Scott. He scores! Dennis Scott has scored for Georgia Tech, and there's mayhem at Alexander Memorial Coliseum.
Tech at Maryland with only 0.2 seconds left on the clock. James Forrest took a flying leap toward the basket, caught the inbounds pass, and gently put up the winning score. A capacity crowd at the Thriller Dome. Score tied at 66, the last 10 seconds.
We have had one heck of a basketball game here today.
Wake Forest coming out nose-to-nose in a man-to-man defense. They've got Anthony Tichy back, though, to protect the basket.
Joseph back to Petway. 9 seconds left. Petway on the wing. Petway near the corner. 5 seconds left. Petway launches and hits it with 3 seconds to play. And Georgia Tech is up by 2 with 3 seconds to go. Wake Forest gets a timeout. Oh!
Well, Petway's given his team a lift this whole second half, but that may be the biggest shot of his young career at Georgia Tech, and this place is going wild.
Ah, but turnabout's fair play. Here's Georgia Tech playing Virginia in the 89-90 season at Charlottesville. Tech's Carl Brown at the line.
67-65 Jackets.
Georgia Tech is telling Lenny Wirtz that if he makes the free throw, they want a timeout to set the defense.
Missed it. London, the rebound, pops free. Turner's got it.
10 seconds.
Melting down. 9, 8. John Crotty. Up top, Kenny Turner. They've got to hurry. Oliver, 2-point shot, won't help him. All right, well, it ties it. Tie game, and we've got overtime. I was thinking Tech was up, but it's tied at 67.
You got to be kidding.
79-79.
You were wondering about his confidence.
Wonder no more.
No timeout signal from Virginia.
They'll try to win it here. London to Stiff to Turner. 9 seconds. 8. Kenny Turner, the hero of the moment. Now Georgia Tech coming up 2-1. Kenny Anderson. No, Virginia wins. Cassell follows. Inside. Yes! Off the glass.
By Cassell. What a big, big play. All the way to
the... Nothing translates the tension and excitement of a close college ball game better than an enthusiastic broadcast crew. In these next few fantastic finishes, we're going to let the call tell it all. January 12, 1983, Carmichael Auditorium, Maryland versus North Carolina. The Terps have led most of the game, but now the Heels have pulled even.
Jordan hits the free throw again.
and it's tied 69-69. This is Baxter against pressure. Long pass to Branch. Branch to Beal. Beal puts it up and in. And Maryland retakes the lead, 71-69. There you see the clock, 24 seconds. Could it be a three-point play? Will they go for that? Braddock may, does not take the shot. Jordan to Braddock, 15 seconds left. Braddock, three-pointer, good! Jimmy Braddock, a three-pointer! Holy cow, what a shot! Let's reset the stage for you. It's North Carolina 72, Maryland 71. The Terps with the basketball, 5 seconds left. Adkins to Chuck Drizel. Drizel drives the baseline. It's blocked. Ball's out of bounds. There's no time left on the clock. No whistle.
Maryland got what they wanted. They got the open man. Chuck Drizel made a great baseline drive. He went up in traffic. And it looked like a clean block. There was some contact, but both players were going up strong. Perkins was there to swat it away. Nothing was called, obviously.
On the replay, you could see that Perkins got a hand on it, and Jordan came from the weak side to get a hand on it. Certainly, Drizel had a wide open shot at the bucket. And we're looking at the replay again, and it was really Jordan. Perkins may have gotten a fingertip on it, but if it hadn't been for Michael Jordan, I think Chuck Drizel would have been able to come through and hit that basket and win the ball game for Maryland.
In 1985, the Omni in Atlanta was abuzz with hometown favorite Georgia Tech in its first ACC final. Here's the call late in the game.
They're on the edge of their seats at the Omni. 1 minute even left in the championship game, tied at 50. Tech will have to shoot again. Price going down the lane all the way, and he's fouled. 53-50, Georgia Tech on top of North Carolina. 22 seconds left to go in this ball game.
What a great game it has been, and let's give hats off to Georgia Tech. They battled back all afternoon. North Carolina's played a super game. Their first lead in the game came with 52 seconds left when they went up 51-50. But let's face it, they're playing against the master over there in the light blue. Dean Smith knows how to use these last 22 seconds. I have a friend, Mike, that said if he only had 5 minutes to live, he'd want Dean Smith there to help him enjoy it.
Buzz Peterson is in for North Carolina as Dean Smith wants a little bit more shooting ability.
Mark Price really guarding Kenny Smith. They want to make it a little difficult for North Carolina to bring the ball up the floor.
Smith goes to the baseline, takes a jumper, and hits it with 14 seconds left in the game. We are now down to 1 point again, 53-52. Sally will inbound.
North Carolina with a much smaller team. Buzz Peterson in there, Curtis Hunter, and Hale and Kenny Smith. So they're really got a quick pressing team on the floor right
and
now.
And Kenny Smith is on Price. They get it to Petway. Petway back to Price. Price double team, trying to get it up court to Joseph. Joseph gets it off to Mark Price, 14. The clock has not been running. The clock was not running at all. Do you believe that? The clock did not run the entire time, and they must have used up 8 or 9 seconds.
And Bobby Crimmins, let's take a look at it. 1,001, 1,002, 1,003. 1,004, 1,005, 1,006, 1,007, 1,008, and now the clock starts.
I thought Avon Joseph was fouled in the backcourt. Carolina tried to foul him, but apparently it wasn't quite obvious enough, and Price will go back to the free throw line where he has been perfect. Yesterday he hit 14 out of 14. He's now hit 23 in a row. Now they set it back to 8 seconds. And I believe that's a couple of ticks more than it ought to be. Price hits the free throw. Had a little rim on that one, but got it in.
Hey, for the young people at home, Bobby Crimmins holds his heart. I think everybody else thinks he's designing a play, but
Price hits them both. A three-point lead, 55-52. Long pass down court, intercepted by Dalrymple. I think it just struck him what they've been able to do.
Let's listen to parts of the live call of Virginia great Ralph Sampson's last game at University Hall.
81 for Maryland, 80 for Virginia. 49 seconds left to go in the ball game, and now we've got contact underneath again. And it looked like Fothergill trying to hold Sampson. So they'll hit Mark Fothergill with the foul. The problem is it sends Ralph Sampson to the free throw line where he can put his ball club back on top. He has hit 6 of 9 today. Missed the front half of the 1-1. Maryland has the ball and the lead with 43 seconds left in this game.
What an amazing finale to the regular season. ACC basketball at its best.
Rivers on the dribble, gives it to Branch, and Branch is fouled by Carlisle. This is Branch. Front half of the 1-1. Big shots, and he missed it. Gets the ball back. Then Branch double-teamed, and it's stolen by Wilson. Othell Wilson will set it up. 24 seconds left. Maryland by one. This is Carlisle. They're looking low for Sampson. Wilson, 17 seconds left. Holy cow.
Maryland still in the 2-3. Othell Wilson, tough shot.
Sampson. Shot is blocked. Oh, boy. 7 seconds left. And Ralph Sampson, in his final game, will go to the free throw line with a two-shot foul. Now Terry Holland telling his ball club what happens in case Sampson misses the first, makes the first, misses the second, makes both, or what?
You know, this is the toughest time for the coach because you hate to sit there talking to a player and says, if Ralph misses these
right.
two, you want to say, Ralph, don't worry, you're going to go, but you got to plan for everything. And that's the great thing about college basketball.
Ralph Sampson will go to the free throw line for the front end of a 1-1. Sampson with a career high against Maryland, 21 points. He has hit 6 of 10 today. He could tie it and then put his team in the lead if he makes both. 2 free throws. This is not a 1-1. And he misses the first. So that the best Virginia is going to come out of this with 7 seconds left, is a tie. And then it's up to Maryland to decide its strategy. Ralph Sampson, the premier player in the world, with a free throw. And he missed it. In and out, tipped outside. Sampson has it. And he scores. Here's the length of the court pass. Adrian Branch will put it up at the buzzer. No whistle, no foul. And Virginia will celebrate the final game of Ralph Sampson's home college career with an 83-81 victory over Maryland.
No doubt about it, the coaches, players, and everyone who's been a part of ACC basketball have given us some great finishes to look back on. Now, of course, we couldn't include every great finish here, and there will certainly be more to look forward to in the future. Thanks to everyone who has made the ACC what it is, a great place to finish.